Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Hare Krishna. Reading from the Bhagavad Gita as it is, chapter 1, text number 42. This chapter is entitled Observing the Armies. Dosharetai kulagnanam varna sankara karakai utsyadyante jati dharma kuladharmascha shashvataha. By the evil deeds of those who destroy the family tradition and thus give rise to unwanted children, all kinds of community projects and family welfare activities are devastated. Purport by Srila Prabhupada. Community projects for the four orders of human society, combined with family welfare activities, as they are set forth by the institution of Sanatana Dharma or Varnashram Dharma, are designed to enable the human being to attain his ultimate salvation. Therefore, the breaking of the Sanatana Dharma tradition by irresponsible leaders of society brings about chaos in that society. And consequently, people forget the aim of life, Vishnu. Such leaders are called blind. And persons who follow such leaders are sure to be led into chaos. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militamena Tasmai Shri Gurubai Namaha. Namam Vishnupadaya Krishna Prashtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swamin Itinabene Namaste Sarasvate Deve Gauravani Pracharane Nirvishesha Shunyamadi Paschat Deshatarane Vancha Kalpatarubhascha Kripa Sindhubhevacha Patita Nam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Haripri. Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. Thank you. By the evil deeds of those who destroy the family tradition and thus give rise to unwanted children, all kinds of community projects and family welfare activities are devastated. Hare Krishna. So, Arjuna is raising objections about why he should not fight. And if you study, Arjuna's objections are very reasonable, logical, practical, well thought, responsible. And therefore, Krishna does not condemn Arjuna's logic. But what Krishna objects is Arjuna's decision. Sometime, one may have good reason and logic, but the decision may be wrong. So Arjuna, basically, because these things will happen, therefore I will not fight. So he forgot to understand that actually there was no choice. In life, many times, we have to choose between the two evil. Choosing between two good is a prosperity. Should I go to Vrindavan or Mayapur, right? So that confusion is easy to handle in one sense. There may be a confusion, but there is no fear of offending anybody. choosing between good and bad is also one sense easy. Right. That there is evil party and there is a good party. Very clear distinction. In the Mahabharata, Vyasadeva, when he begins his Mahabharata, he explains that I am describing two kinds of trees. There is a tree, it's a tree of Manyumayo Mahadruma. There is a tree of anger. And who is that tree? That is the tree called as Duryodhan. And who are the branches and fruits, twigs? He says Dushasan, Shakuni, Karna and all the other brothers. And who is the root of that tree? Adharma and Dhritarashtra. So Vyasadeva is making very clear distinction, there is no confusion. And then he says there is another tree. Dharmamaya Mahadrumaha. There is a tree of Dharma. And who is that tree? Yudhishthira Maharaj is that tree. And who are the branches and fruits? Bhima, Arjuna and Nakula and Sahadeva. And who is the root of that tree? Dharma, Krishna and the Brahmanas. So when such clear distinction is made, you don't have a confusion unless someone is a pervert. No, I want to follow adharma only. There is a person, I met him, he's a writer. So he's written a book on Ravan and Duryodhan. He said, everybody has written book from Ram and Pandava's perspective, you know, because victors always glorify themselves. So I want to write from the perspective of Duryodhan and Ravan. I told him, very good, that you have such a good quality that you want to find good in bad people. We will also learn from you. You know, it's a good thing to find good in bad people. But unfortunately, what you are doing is that in the name of finding good in bad people, you are making good people evil. That is the problem. Because when you have to glorify Duryodhan, you can say there was some good quality in Duryodhan. What is that? Like Prabhupada said, when Pandavas came to Duryodhan, he had given 5 arrows. Bhishma Dev had given 5 arrows to our Duryodhan. He said, I will kill the Pandavas tomorrow. So now when Krishna is there, whatever plan you have, it will fail only. Moghasha Moga Karmano. So Krishna told the Pandavas that Bhishma has given 5 arrows to Duryodhan. And you go and ask from him. Because Pandavas had helped Duryodhan to be released from the clutches of the Gandharvas. Now Duryodhan was very humiliated by that because he couldn't take service from anybody. In fact, it's a very humorous also. When Yudhishthira Maharaj got to know that Duryodhan has been captured by the Gandharvas, some of the soldiers, they came running to Yudhishthira Maharaj. The soldiers of Duryodhan says, Master, he said, look, you know, Duryodhan has been captured, please release him. So Yudhishthira Maharaj called Bhima and Arjuna. He said, look, you know, Duryodhan has been captured, we should release him. He said, come on. He said, why should we? What we could not achieve with all our weapons and everything, these Gandharvas have done for us, so let us celebrate their victory. Then Yudhishthira said, no, no. He said, look, for insiders we are 105. We are 5, they are 100. For outsiders, we are together. We are 105. We are together because we are Kurukul. So we can't allow that to happen. Bhima said, I don't listen to all these things. It is not practical. So that did not make Bhima to go and protect. So Yudhishthira Maharaj, understanding the mood of Bhima, because he was also a diplomat, a Rajkiya leader. So what Yudhishthira Maharaj told Bhima, my dear Bhim, look, what is the greatest pain for Duryodhan? Greatest pain for Duryodhan is to be compassionate by enemy. If you are compassionate to Bhima, if you are compassionate to Duryodhana, that he cannot handle. So in your protecting Duryodhana, there is our victory. See, a devotee, one who is not doing any diplomacy, who is not part of this world, their compassion has no agenda. But someone who is like powerful Yudhishthira Maharaj, he has a compassion, but he can use that compassion for scoring against his enemies. Because he is in the ruling system. Same thing in the Ramayana also. When Sugriva told Lord Ramachandra, he said, come on, you cannot allow Vibhishan, because Vibhishan is, after all, he is betraying his brother. How can you accept him? If he was actually sincere, he should have come before the war took place. He is coming at the last moment. You know, it is known that you will win. Therefore, he joined you. He said, don't accept him. Ram said, no, that cannot happen, because he has come asking my shelter. I will give him my shelter. Then Sugriva said, but he could harm us. He could cause harm to us. Ram said, look, nobody can harm me. With my thumb, I said, I can punch everyone. I can destroy everybody. He said, don't worry. Because Lord Ramachandra had a compassion, but he also had the capacity to be compassionate. If we are not having the capacity, then you can't be compassionate, because somebody is drowning when you swim. You always ask, you know swimming? They said, yes, little bit. You may know swimming, but you may not know how to save others. There is a difference between swimming and also being expert in saving others. If you don't know how to save, always stay away from those who are novice in swimming, because they'll drown along with you. Your compassion will not help you to save them, neither help you to protect yourself. So Bhima, when he heard that, yes, this compassion of my brother towards Duryodhan will only make Duryodhan more miserable, then Bhima agreed to go there. He went and protected. So therefore, we see that in the Sanatan Dharma here, Arjuna's reason, logic is all very good. His decision is bad. So as we were discussing the two trees, very clear distinction between good and the bad. But when you have to make a choice between the two evil, you don't have a choice other than choosing one of the evil. Again, Ramayana also. Nobody ever says that what Ram did to Sita is right. How can you defend it? It is not defendable. It is not possible that Lord Ramachandra could cause such a pain to Mother Sita for the cause of the citizen. But the problem was, there was no other option available. If you read Valmiki Ramayana, people grumble, people cry, people become angry. I know so many people in India. They say, we can handle Krishna, but you know, Ram we cannot. We cannot handle Ram. How can you do this? She was completely loyal to Lord Ramachandra. But still Ramachandra abandoned her. In fact, during Dasera and Diwali, one story was circulating. You must also have read that one mother asked her daughter, baby, I am pregnant. What do you want? Whom do you want? You want Ram? She said, no, mom, I want Ravan as my brother. Mother said, what? What happened to you that you want Ravan as brother? He said, mommy, look, what did Ram do to Mother Sita? She was dedicated, loyal to him, but he abandoned her. And just see Ravan. Ravan laid down his life for the cause of his sister, Shurpanaka. So whom should I choose? Should I choose Ravan-like brother who will die for his sister, or Ram-like brother who will abandon his wife? Mother said, wow, very good, good enlightenment. So the mother said, yes, Betty, you know, I will follow your footsteps. But she forgot to. Now this story was circulating. It's another perspective. Everybody has their own perspective, but this is another perspective. But what perspective? Ravan was known for abusing women to such an extent, in the public assembly, In the assembly, one of the ministers of Ravana asked him this question. He said, why are you making all this discussion? You know, you want Sita rape her. Why don't you rape her? In the assembly, whether it is Ravana's assembly or the Asat Sabha in Hastinapur when they are trying to disrobe Draupadi. Shameless people. They had no guilt also. He asked him, why don't you rape her? So Ravana said, I want to. But unfortunately, I cannot do because I've been cursed. And there are people, there was one author in India, he got the highest award. There is a different kinds of award in India. One award is called as Gyanapita Award. Gyanapita is given to some of the best poets, writers. So one of these authors, he says, Ram was very, very impatient in regards to battling against Ravan, killing Ravan. Ravan had no intention of harming Mother Sita. If it was his real intention, why would he wait for 10 months? Have you ever seen anywhere in the world that people wait for 10 months? Actually, Ravan was very adventurous. If Ram had come back, he would say, oh, take back your Sita. But he forgot to read in the Valmiki Ramayana this section where he said, I want to rape her, but I cannot because I've been cursed. How much people twist and turn. Therefore, choosing between the two evil, eventually Lord Ramachandra, when he had to abandon Mother Sita, he never said, I'm doing the right thing. He never defended his activities. It was a position where there was no other choice. Many times it happens like that in life. You have to choose between my wife or my mother, right? You love both of them. You can't be upset, but life does like that. What to do? You have to pacify your mother also, and you have to pacify your wife also. Nobody's angry, but people, those who see from outside, they say, hey, he's evil. Either way, they'll call you evil. Right? Like, I think Saraswati Thakur told that story. One man along with his son, they were walking, they were riding a donkey. And people said, what is this, poor animal, you're riding on it, are you not ashamed of it? So then they decided, okay, the father got down, son was riding. People said, hey, come on, how shameless son you are. You are making your father walk and you're riding. So then they exchanged. Father was riding and the son was walking. He said, oh, come on, shameless, you're making your child walk. Both got down. And the donkey was walking alone and two people were walking. They said, what a foolish people. They have such a donkey and they're not riding also. So it is explained that in this world, you cannot convince people about anything. It is very difficult to convince. So people will always question, grumble, cry foul against Lord Ramachandra. But the problem was choosing between the two evil. And that is what is happening with Arjun also. It is not about fighting against Duryodhan. He could easily handle him. It's not again fighting against Dushyasan. Dushyasan is such a character in the Mahabharata. Not even I thought of regret for what he did. Even during the battle when Bhima brought him down, he was sitting on his chest. And he asked him, hey, Dushyasan, which hand was it which touched Draupadi's sacred hairs? He said, this hand. He says like that. That is how Bhima pulled out his hand. Because there was no regret only. Absolutely no regret. He was getting punishment. Therefore, sometimes it is explained, punishment when you offer to someone, if there is no regret, what is the point? Sometime, we in our school also, some of the kids, if you give remarks to someone who never got the remark, for them it is a nightmare. But somebody who has a remark 15 times, they said 16th one, no problem. It doesn't matter to them. Somebody has never failed. If they fail, they feel hurt. Somebody has always failed, he said one more time. So punishment and failing does not discourage them, does not transform them. Therefore, it is explained that punishment has to be based upon the principle of reformation. If it doesn't work, there is no point in punishment, if there is no reformation. So here Bhishma was the, Prabhupada writes in one of the purports, what is Arjuna's problem? Arjuna's problem was Bhishma and Dronacharya. And therefore Krishna realized his weakness. What was the weakness? When Arjuna said, Krishna, take my horses between the two armies. I want to see who has come to fight against me. And Krishna realized. Krishna realized that Arjuna asking this question, like if you are a surgeon, you are supposed to go to the operation theater. You don't ask, whom should I operate? Are any patient is supposed to be operated, you close your eyes. Not close, don't close your eyes. You operate them. Right. A person who cleans the garden, when he collects all the dry leaves, he sets it to fire. So there is no, he's not angry with those leaves. He's indifferent, he's neutral. But here, because when Krishna took his chariot in the presence of Dronacharya and Bhishma, then Arjuna's emotions all came out. He said, how can I do it? Therefore, one time Prabhupada, in the middle of the night, he called his servant, another devotee. And then he said, do you see? He said, being devotee is not easy. Because you have to kill Bhishma and Dronacharya. He said, go and take rest. Huh? It is very difficult. If you hate somebody, then you justify. Or I was doing justice. Now, sometime in the police department back in India, the police beat the criminals. Many times more than beating to reform them, it is pleasure in beating. Huh? But you also have a justification because they're criminals. Or sometime authorities. It happens in the temples also. Right? The authorities have some problem with you and you make a mistake. So what happens? They have a justification to chastise you. But can you justify with your own self? That is the difficulty. So Arjuna was so conscious and sensitive, very reluctant. He said, Krishna, I can't. But he is not able to say directly. Therefore, he is giving all these reasons, which are very valid also. Very valid reasons he is giving. But real point is what? He cannot kill Bhishma and Dronacharya. And after what? What did they do? In one sense, if you see the whole story of, like Prabhupada explains in the Gita only, actually Bhishma and Dronacharya, by being neutral, indirectly supported disrobing of Draupadi, the attempted disrobe of Draupadi, and they were supposed to be punished for a death penalty. Shastra is talking about it, and not only they were supposed to be punished, and they chose to fight on behalf of the Kauravas. And they told also, when Yudhishthira Maharaj walked in their presence after the Bhagavad Gita was over, Yudhishthira Maharaj got down from his chariot, he started walking towards the opposite army. Everybody was shocked. Array, what happened to Yudhishthira Maharaj? You can't predict anything about him. He should say, I am not going to fight anymore, I am going to the forest and take sannyas. That was his regular, outburst. So he started walking. Bhima said, what is he doing? He told Krishna. Krishna said, just keep quiet. So, Krishna said, keep quiet. And when they came to Bhishma and Dronacharya, Yudhishthira Maharaj offered his obeisances. He said, please bless me for the victory. Now Bhishma couldn't say no to him. Just imagine how much culture they had that somebody comes to ask blessing from you and you are right, even they are on the other side, you cannot say, I will not bless you. That itself is adharma. So he had to bless. Bhishma said, I bless you, my dear Yudhishthir, that you'll be victorious, but I can't fight on your behalf because I am the servant of Artha. Artha is nobody's servant. Basically, the wealth is nobody's servant. I become servant of the wealth, therefore I cannot fight on your behalf, but I can bless you. Same thing happened with Dronacharya also. They were forced to bless Yudhishthira Maharaj. On the other hand, Gandhari, when Duryodhan went to seek blessing from her, he said, I can't bless you, my dear son. How can I bless you for your victory? Because wherever there is Krishna, yato Krishna tato dharma, yato dharma tato jayaha. Wherever there is Krishna, there is victory. I can only pray for long life to you, but I cannot pray for your victory because I cannot offer that blessing. So blessings had meaning in those days. It worked also. Nowadays the blessing also doesn't work. Sometimes the curses work. Because negative have bad powers, right? So blessings had the power. So just imagine Yudhishthira, Arjuna, even after 13 years, can you imagine? When did they meet Bhishma and Dronacharya? Nobody came to see Pandavas when they were incognito or in the forest, except Krishna came repeatedly. Bhishma could have come. He had not taken Kshetra Sannyas. Dronacharya should have come. He did not come. In fact, one of his teachers, Daumya, basically we don't hear much about Daumya Rishi. Actually, Daumya was a greater influence in the life of the Pandavas than Dronacharya. Dronacharya is like a tuition teacher. No, he had an agenda also. But Daumya Rishi stayed with Pandavas in their good times and in their bad times also. During the 12 years of exile, Daumya travelled with them. He didn't say, "Arey, you don't have any kingship now. I'm going to be the Purohit of the Kauravas." No, he travelled with them 12 years. Only during the incognito, because they could be recognized, he moved away from there. 13 years they did not come. But when Arjuna was fighting the battle with the Viratas, with the Kauravas on behalf of Virata, Arjuna saw Dronacharya and Bhishma from distance. First time he's seeing after 13 years. They also had a lot of affection. Dronacharya had a lot of affection for Arjuna, but the problem was he couldn't trade his prosperity, his comfort for affection too. When there was a choice between affection towards Arjuna and giving up Duryodhan, he said, I love Arjuna, but I cannot give up my comforts. He did not do that. So what Arjuna does, he sees Drona and Bhishma and Kripacharya and shoots an arrow. One arrow comes close to the ears of Drona, Bhishma and Kripacharya. One comes at their feet. And Vasudeva explains, Arjuna is so cultured during the war also. There was such a culture even during the war. And sometime in our cultural festival also we have wars. Huh? How to do it, how not to do it. So he shot and took their blessings. Therefore imagine for Arjuna how difficult it was. He had all the rights. Dharma was on his side, Krishna on his own side, history was on his side. And someone who is not doing anything when Draupadi was being disrobed, that is the one of the greatest crime ever committed in the history of creation. No parliament house, no president's house, no upper house, no lower house, you know. They do act whimsically, you know, very uncivilized. But nobody has ever tried this one, trying to disrupt Draupadi. And in presence of whom? The good people became party to adharma by remaining silent. They became less than the vulture Jatayu. Jatayu fought valiantly, even though Sita only asked Jatayu to inform Lord Ramachandra that Ravan has kidnapped her. But that's what she had asked him to do. But Jatayu said, no, how can I? How can I just see and not do anything? You know, he fought against Ravan. He laid down his life. He died. And he was misunderstood also, just before dying. Then Ramachandra realized, okay, you know, this bear has died for us. But here nobody did anything. Nobody did anything. Therefore, basically, they were supposed to be given death penalty. Still, Arjuna is so reluctant. And what a reason he's giving. Basically, when we think, we see in this world, we always see from a very immediate perspective. Today, my fun. Tomorrow, my fun. Sometimes people don't even see from tomorrow's perspective. Arjuna is seeing from today's perspective. The war will cause limitless violence. Arjuna is seeing from tomorrow's perspective. What is that? If this war happens, then women will be unprotected. And what will happen if they are not protected? Unscrupulous men will always exist in this world, unfortunately. And you don't need many. You need one nasty person. He can cause havoc. So he said, if they do like that, then so many unwanted children will be born. And if they're born like that, then they will not offer oblations to their forefathers. They will have not gratitude, and because of that, the forefathers will basically get stuck. They will not progress. So Krishna, can you imagine what kind of problem it will happen? So Arjuna is thinking about the present. Arjuna is thinking about the future. And Arjuna is thinking about the post-future also. From every perspective he's covering. Very responsible. Therefore Prabhupada said Arjuna was anyway compassionate to his own soldiers. Now he was becoming compassionate to the enemies also. Why? Because Arjuna was very sensitive, very reluctant. Just imagine for a soldier, it is important that they are more reluctant. If they are very enthusiastic to kill, they become brutal. Only a soldier, a real soldier, not a terrorist, a real soldier has the courage to kill if there is a need, and only they have the courage to save in the most difficult situation. Now, I was in Kashmir last year. On the day of when Burhanwani was killed, if you know about Indian politics. And we were in Anantnag district only. And we had a program for the soldiers. And we were talking with them. And many times whenever there is drought situation, when there is flood, because Kashmir gets affected by flood, whom do you think, who saves them? These people only save them. In fact, when America, first time they were experimenting this nuclear weapon, the power of nuclear bomb, they asked the scientist. I think Truman, he was the president then. So they asked the scientist, where should we experiment this bomb? They said, wherever there is a density of population. So they were shocked. He said, what? He said, yes, unless we make this experiment in the density of population, we will not come to know. They thought, my God, if the scientists are saying like this, what to speak of the soldier? They'll be more brutal. So they actually asked the soldier, hoping to hear very dangerous answer. And the soldier said, drop wherever there is no human inhabitation. Sensitivity. Because soldier is not trained to kill. Soldier is trained to protect. There is a different psychology among the soldiers if you actually talk to them. But if you talk to a terrorist, he is not trained to save people. In his whole psychology is to kill, 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 kill. There is nothing such concept of saving. So Arjuna, on the battlefield of Kurukshetra, where people call, oh, how can Krishna create this war? You know, all Sanatan Dharma scripture, whether it is Bhagavatam, whether it is Ramayana, whether it is Mahabharata, all the devatas have weapons in their hands. Nobody is standing with peace. Lord Buddha is, see how peaceful he is. But the point is, world is not designed like that. We wish how world should be. But our wish do not fulfill. We always try to look for a third choice which does not exist. Right? We always try to find third choice which does not exist in the world. You have to choose between the two only. The third does not exist. Arjuna was wishing Krishna, even if they attack me with all their weapons, even though I am unarmed, he said, that will not matter to me. I will go begging in the forest. Bhiksham api aloke, api trailokya rajasam. Even if I get the wealth of the three world, Krishna, I will not attack them. Now you have to understand, for a Kshatriya who is always given charity, Arjun was known for giving dana bhiksha, dan. Arjun was known for giving vidya dan, abhay dan, and then annadan. Dan was always their nature, to give, to give, to give. Even they had nothing, they got this Akshay Patra to give to 60,000 students. So they never stayed away from charity. So where did this desire of begging came from? He said, I'll go and beg also. So the desire to beg came to Arjuna, one, because of his he kind of became bewildered. And secondly, in the Mahabharata, it's a beautiful, you can understand how someone is evil, how can they use the goodness of others. Dhritarashtra sent Sanjay as a messenger, and the messenger came to Pandavas. And what was the message? The message said, my dear Pandavas, you are conditioned to live in the forest. You are born in the forest. Then you begged in the forest for many years. Therefore, what is the point in fighting against your relatives? It will cause big war. Therefore, I tell you that do not be responsible for this war. Duryodhana is spoiled brat. Let him rule. Let him rule. Why you want to be responsible for creating war? He said, I give you an option that you beg. Beg and continue to live. Because begging is, you know how to do it. My son cannot do it. Another thing, that don't come and beg in Hastinapur because I'll be criticized. So go and beg in Dwarka. So this Dhritarashtra, the blind man, you know, he's so wicked and cruel. He acts very, you know, like, oh, I'm weak, you know, I can't do anything, my son is evil, I can't protect him, I can't stop him. So that was his, so somewhere when he made that statement, some statements which are made in the most serious situation, we don't realize when they affect. Therefore, I think, you know, always devotees tell this, when you preach Krishna consciousness to people, you planted the seed. Don't say that, oh, now it is all waste. We don't know when they will take to Krishna consciousness. But whenever you planted that seed, it is sprouting inside. It is taking roots. And at the right place, at the right time, you may not know them. But somewhere, they take to Krishna consciousness. Then you meet them after 10 years. Hey, you are the same person? No. They say, yeah, you know, you had told me something, but I did not take it seriously. I remember one devotee was telling me, he was a big businessman into, they used to make electronics, some wireless sets. Big businessman, somebody came distributing books to him. And he said, okay, he didn't take big interest, but because he was pious, he said, okay, you know, the person has come to distribute. He took that book and he kept it in his shelf. Never looked it. So this businessman, he wanted to go public. It was a private company, then he went to public, but unfortunately it didn't click. He lost everything what he invested. There was nothing, not even one penny with him. He had taken big risk. And that is the time he decided to commit suicide. He said, now I can't stand, I can't face the people. When he was about to commit suicide, some other, he remembered, somebody gave me Bhagavad Gita. And he pulled the Bhagavad Gita. And by pulling that Bhagavad Gita, he changed his mind of committing suicide. And he's still living, okay? Not as a ghost, as a devotee. So therefore, that doesn't go vain. So Dhritarashtra, being very wicked and crooked, he planted this seed. Therefore, in the first chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, Prabhupada is talking about what was Dhritarashtra's hope, that Pandavas' good behavior will prevail and they will walk away from the battlefield. Therefore, the bad people want good people to be very good. Huh? And therefore, sometimes they'll say, why are you? How can you do it? You are a good person, no? Because as much good you are, that much they can increase their evil behavior. They will preach to you. You know, you should always be good. Therefore, Krishna is not talking about good and bad. He is talking about the impact, the consequences. Because the world is designed in such a way that you become stuck to being good. And if that good becomes an exploitation against you, what is the point of being good? Like sometimes the parents, I always talk about this in our parenting seminar. The parents, they always talk about giving selfless love to their children. Unconditional. Nowadays, children always talk, you know, Prabhuji, my parents do not love me unconditionally. I said, what about you? Huh? Just like you are expecting them to love you unconditionally, You should also love unconditionally. Why you only? No, they say they're superiors, na? That is their responsibility to love us unconditionally. They have all the logic. And parents many times do love their children unconditionally without realizing world is not designed for their children. Wherever they go, that the world will love them unconditionally. World is unconditionally ruthless. If you do not bargain for their own good, unconditional love pampers them, and the very parent who gave unconditional love unconsciously, indirectly become responsible for the downfall of their own children. Therefore, tough love is also very important. Love is there, but it is tough. It has to be tough. So we see here, Yudhishthira, Arjuna was spoken by Duryodhan, Dhritarashtra like that. And he was hoping that Pandavas will do like that. But fortunately, for Pandavas, Krishna was there. In this world, as I discussed, that Buddha's philosophy is good if you are living in an ashram. And that too in an ashram where there is no management involved. Pure, just you are doing your bhajan. Nothing but bhajan, you are begging a little bit. Then Buddha's philosophy works. What is that? Nirvana. You know, I don't want anything. But if you're doing some management, then justice is very much required. Otherwise, it will be misused. Like somebody wrote, what if Lord Buddha was riding Arjuna's chariot? First of all, he would not ride a chariot. Because that is against ahimsa. And in case if he had, if Arjuna would say, Krishna, Lord Buddha, you know, I don't want to fight. He said, enlightened. Now you're enlightened. But life is not like that. Life is not poetry. You can write poetry about life. But life is not a poetry. Life is very realistic. Therefore, Krishna's Gita, as Prabhupada calls it, as it is, Krishna does not wish anything. Because wishing does not make it a reality. You have to deal with the reality. The evil forces will always exist within and without also. Therefore, because Krishna was there, Krishna, rather than telling Yudhishthira Maharaj and Arjuna, seeing the vishada of Arjuna, vishada can never be enlightenment. Vishada is always roga only, it's a disease. Reluctance in doing something good, it cannot be a wisdom. I don't want to take part. Walking away from life is not renunciation, it is escapism. One will not grow in that. So Arjuna's walking away from battlefield, some people may call it as an enlightenment. Some people may call it as what a wisdom. There is a professor in America, you know, she says that Krishna is the greatest warmonger. Arjuna did not want to fight. Can you imagine Arjuna's choice was perpetual violence caused by Duryodhan or one-time violence caused by Krishna? Which one will you choose? Perpetual violence, continuous violence. I remember one of the terrorists who was responsible for killing hundreds of young people in our Mumbai train blast. She was about to be hanged. It was a huge hue and cry, array, his daughter is grown up, they should not hang him. And one devotee called me. He said, Prabhuji, he said, how can devotees take part in discussing about hanging him? They're also, you know, they're saying they should be hanged. You know, we should not be thinking about it. I said, very good. He said, you want yes or no answer or you want detailed answer? And I know him since he was a very small child. I said, look, our shastras, I asked him a question, which is there in the scripture also, that if somebody abuses, rapes a woman and murders and eventually becomes completely repentful, complete transformation, he said, what to do with him? Should you forgive him or should you give him a death penalty? Many so-called people who talk about, you know, human rights, they'll see has changed. But the Shastra says, yes, certainly has changed. But what does he teaching other such people who are potentially rapists? At least one time I will be forgiven. Can you imagine? by making them feel like that is one time I'll be forgiven, you are putting so many women's situation into greatest risk. Therefore, even though he's transformed, even though there is a change in him, on a physical level, he has to be given death penalty. There is no forgiveness in this regard. So that others are deterred from that and lot of people are protected. Just see how Shastras are certainly sensitive, but they're not emotional. Like in the Bhagavatam purport, Draupadi told Krishna, she told Arjun, then don't kill Dronacharya's son, Ashwatthama. I understand the pain of being motherless woman. And Drauni, she has lost her husband recently. And now if you kill Ashwatthama also, it's not very good. And Bhima saying, finish him off. Such people should not live. So Arjuna had a dilemma. And Prabhupada writes, contradictory introduction of authorities is very difficult to execute. Your GBC is telling do this. And your president is telling exactly opposite of that. And you are like sandwiched. What to do? But Prabhupada says, because Arjuna was very intelligent, he realized what to do. And Prabhupada writes in the purport that Draupadi's sentiments were good, but they were not practical. They were not practical. So therefore, many times, these so-called intellectuals sitting in their nice cabin, posh area, they talk about humanitarian things. Oh, this should not happen, that should not happen. And the original cause of all this is Krishna and Ram. They were responsible for all this warmongering. But surgery, when it has to be done, it has to be done. It was a choice between perpetual violence. What kind of people are they? Duryodhan, basically, Dushyasan, Karana, Shakuni, you want them to rule the country? Some people argue, actually Duryodhan was a good king. Good king at what cost? He charged taxes 10 years ahead. Mahabharata explains that. Karana is the one, he was the one who told, actually he was responsible. He was the one who told Dushyasan. He said, Draupadi, she's married 5 men. She's like a prostitute only. Therefore, whether she's there with cloth or without cloth, doesn't matter. As if a prostitute does not have a dignity. No scripture says, just because somebody is a prostitute, you can disrobe her in public place. That also invites for big punishment. And that is how the Dushyasan started disrobing Draupadi. Therefore, Arjuna had no other choice. And unfortunately, on top of that, what happened? The good people are siding the Kauravas. Many times it happens. The best of the people are working for the worst of the companies. So what do you do? As much as you are honest, very transparent in your skills, that much is good for the corrupt companies. Because you only help them increase their profit. And sometimes people say, I am very honest. But whom are you working for? So Bhishma and Dronacharya were very honest, loyal servants. But whom are they working for? They're working for Duryodhan. So they being in their party and promising that every day we will kill 10,000 soldiers. Drona is saying, I will kill. Imagine what would be the conditions for Krishna. He had to speak to Arjun only when Arjun asked. Of course, Krishna did not begin teaching Bhagavad Gita unless Arjun asked. Arjun said, my dear Lord, I am completely confused about my duty. Karpanya dosho pahata svabhava. I am completely confused about my duty. I don't know what to do. So Arjuna's reason, logic, all the arguments did not enlighten him, rather confused him. But one good quality about Arjuna, in the first chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, if you read carefully, there are three lamentations. Duryodhana's lamentation, Dhritarashtra's lamentation, and Arjuna's lamentation. Now, Dhritarashtra's lamentation does not bring enlightenment because he doesn't want. Dhritarashtra only looks for sympathy. He always wants sympathy from people, but no transformation. Nowadays, unfortunately, we see, we want sympathy. When people give a solution, they said, you are very cruel. Now, why are you giving me solution? People don't want solution because solutions are difficult to execute. We always play victim card. Everybody is responsible except myself. Therefore, unless one empowers, but why law of karma is there? Law of karma is not there to accuse us. Law of karma is there to empower us. Very simple principle. Law of karma is not there to accuse. It is meant for empowering us. Because unless we take the responsibility, we don't grow. Others cannot make us grow. We only have to grow. So Dhritarashtra only wanted sympathy. And Duryodhana was so arrogant. If you read the Prabhupada's purport and Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur's purport, they present the conflict of Duryodhana. What was Duryodhana's conflict? Duryodhana was fighting against the Pandavas. He wanted Pandavas to be killed. Their army killing would not matter to Duryodhana. Right. What is it ultimately? You know, your teammate in your team, now India-Pakistan match is happening very soon, as if it is like a war, you know, everywhere it is. So your team, even if four players score centuries, but your team loses, it doesn't make any sense. A personal excellence did not bring the team victory. Still you get out of the tournament. So Bhishma was personally good, killing every day 10,000 soldiers. But he said, I will not kill any of the Pandavas. So what happened? Duryodhana didn't want the soldiers to be killed. He wanted Pandavas to be killed. Dronacharya said the same thing. And the best person where he was depending upon, who? Karna. He had tiff with Bhishmadev. He said, as long as Bhishmadev lives, I'm not going to fight. Just see, he's praying that his own commander-in-chief should die. Then only I can come inside the battlefield. So there is such a conflict. And secondly, without asking anybody, he promised Mother Kunti that four of your sons will not be killed by me. Arjuna will live or I will live, you'll always have five Pandavas. He never asked Duryodhana. When Krishna told Karna to join his Pandavas party, he said, I will never quit my friend. But you are not quitting your friend, but you are making your friend quit. Because you have taken a promise that I will not kill. So he had fallible soldiers. They were decorative soldiers. All the weapons are there, everything is there, but they are not going to perform their duties. Therefore, this lamentation was haunting Duryodhana, but he couldn't tell anybody. Because for him, telling about his weakness is considered as the greatest defeat. How can I tell anybody? People don't want to share their hearts. One reason is certainly people fear that I'll be exploited. Other reason is people are arrogant. I don't want to. I will handle myself. But Arjuna was so good. After going through all the painful situation of life, he had the honesty to tell Krishna, my dear Lord, I'm confused about my duty. Therefore, the Bhagavad Gita first chapter is not called as Arjuna Vishada Roga. It is called as Arjuna Vishada Yoga. No? Why? Because that Vishada became yoga because it was spoken to Krishna. Honesty was there, confidence was there that Krishna will not misuse me. He had the trust. Weakness should be expressed to those people who will not abuse us. That's very important. Otherwise, sometime you go to someone, like, you know, nowadays psychologist, if you are feeling guilty, they make you shameless. Are nothing, no problem. Our scripture says shamelessness is also sin and feeling guilty is also sin. Feeling responsible, feeling empowered to undo what wrong we have done is dharma. Otherwise, feeling guilty is also bad and feeling shamelessness is also bad. So Arjuna spoke his heart to Krishna. Krishna said, okay, I will speak. And Krishna spoke the entire Bhagavad Gita. And speaking the entire Bhagavad Gita, what does Krishna do? Now this is the beauty of a teacher. The great teacher does not impose his ideas. Great teacher does not make legalities of his ideas. A great teacher creates an empowerment about his ideas. Allows the student to think, question. So Arjuna was deeply thinking And not because he was basically brainwashed by Krishna. Arjuna said, my dear Lord, I will yathechasi tatakuru. I will do everything what you say. Not because Krishna brainwashed him. Krishna presented so beautifully, logically. Never forced him. And Krishna did not expect, because Arjuna has heard Bhagavad Gita, now whatever Krishna tells Arjuna will do. No, it didn't work like that. When Dronacharya, when Bhishma Dev on the day, third day, you don't see Arjuna was ruthless. He was still reluctant. Krishna ran from the chariot, rushed towards Bhishma Dev to kill him. Arjuna said, Krishna, don't do it, don't do it. Don't know, people will call ill name about you. He said, I don't care. That is not important for me. My responsibility is to bring down this person. If you don't do, I will do it. He said, no, I promise you I will do it. When did Arjuna promise? Third day. And what happened? Fourth day, fifth day, sixth day, seventh day, eighth day. How much patience Krishna has? He waits for us millions of lifetimes. You know, one day they will come, one day they will come. So ninth day, again Arjuna is not fighting, you know, as if he's offering flowers to Bhishma Dev, performing his Guru Puja. No? So Krishna again got down. He ran to Bhishma to kill him. Arjuna said, no, Krishna, don't do it. I promise you I will kill him tomorrow. So Krishna came back on his chariot. They went back to the camp. The next morning, Arjuna asking, Krishna, I can't do it. How can I kill my grandfather? You know, he's so good to me. I all remember all his childhood pastimes with me. You know, I would run to him. He was Shubhra Vastardhari. Bhishma Dev is personification of purity. His beard is pure. His dress is pure. His heart is pure. His mind is pure. His decisions were done in pure intentions. But unfortunately, every decision became a counterproductive. Can you imagine? Therefore, sometimes just because you are good doesn't mean that you are right. Just because you are good doesn't mean that you are right. And many decisions, when we are taken out of emotional outburst, they become counterproductive. And one of the, this is very interesting. I was sharing this in Houston. That when Draupadi came down, because Vikarna told in the assembly, he said, look, you said that Draupadi has been lost by Yudhishthira Maharaj in the gambling match, but the problem is Yudhishthira lost himself first. Then he gambled Draupadi. Therefore, he doesn't have the right to gamble Draupadi because Draupadi is not under his control because he has lost. So when Vikarna said this, that caused a lot of, you know, anger. Karna chastised him, blasted him. And eventually when Pratikama went to bring Draupadi down, Draupadi said, ask my husband, who lost first? Did he lose him first or he lost? So Pratikama was an ordinary person. He came down running here. She's asking all this question. Now it's a very interesting. Vidura also made this point. Very interesting point Vidura made, that Draupadi is not... This wager is not valid because she cannot be waged by Yudhishthira Maharaj because he is lost. This is what spoken by Vidura and Vikarna also. Now very interesting that a Draupadi, what is her position? Her identity is a Draupadi or is identity the wife? If you see her as wife, she is a lost case. If you see her as a person, then she has the independence. So here Vidura, knowing what is important for Draupadi's protection, he is not identifying Draupadi as wife of Yudhishthira Maharaj. He is identifying her as an independent person whom Yudhishthira Maharaj cannot wage. So protecting her, very interesting. So Draupadi comes down. She comes down and she approaches Bhishma Dev because he is knower of all the dharma. She approaches him and said, my dear grandfather, tell me whether I am lost or Yudhishthira Maharaj lost, and does he have the right to put me in the gambling stake? So Bhishma Dev, he said, you know what? Draupadi, I appreciate that even such difficult condition, you want to practice dharma. He appreciated for her question, which was very, very sensitive question. But what was the answer? The answer was, he said, dharma is very difficult to be analyzed. Very difficult. Now Draupadi was not asking question. She was asking for protection. But Bhishma Dev, rather than protecting her, he thought it's a question answer session. No? If there is some kind of danger, what we are supposed to do? Stop the class. As simple as that. Now other thing may not be important, but it is urgent. It may not have anything to do with Krishna consciousness, but it becomes urgent, it may not be important. So Draupadi was looking for protection, but rather than saying that to her, Bhishma Dev indirectly said, you know what, woman is always controlled by his husband. And that was the time they started causing more harm to her. And therefore Draupadi asked this question to him afterwards, when Yudhishthira Maharaj came asking many, many questions to Bhishma Dev. She said, my dear grandfather, how is that you are going to answer all these questions? Because you did not answer one question of mine. I mean, I asked you that question, Prabhupada tell this story. He said, you couldn't answer even one question. That time Bhishma smiled at her. He said, my dear Draupadi, I was contaminated by eating the grains of Duryodhan. Therefore, neutrality eventually turned into unfavoring Draupadi. He said, now your husband has removed all that blood. What is left is only good intention. Whatever I learned from my teacher, and therefore now I will not make that mistake. And sure enough, whatever Bhishma Dev spoke, you know, one point which it's very interesting. Here he kind of put Draupadi in difficulty by saying that she's always under control. Vidura separated that when she was in danger. No, she's a separate identity. You cannot be putting her in stake. So Yudhishthira Maharaj asked one question in the Mahabharata. Very interesting question, especially for Indians. He said, my dear grandfather, Shastras tell about all the inheritance going to the son. There are no questions which are not answered by Bhishma Dev on a practical level. He said, you tell me that why inheritance has to go to the man? Why not to the daughter also? Because daughter is also equally the, you know, daughter of the father. Now these kind of questions are there in the Mahabharata. Now what does Bhishma Dev answer? Bhishma Dev answers a very good question. He said, look, now he's on the deathbed. Huh? What they're discussing? They're discussing practicality of life. Both Mahajan, Yudhishthira Maharaj is a Mahajan, Bhishma Dev is also Mahajan. But what are they talking? They're talking management, keeping Krishna in the center. Krishna is there. So Bhishma Dev said, my dear Yudhishthira, yes, certainly that is true. When a daughter's marriage is fixed, the husband's party, they come, because the marriage is fixed, they have dhan. Dhan is wealth, and wealth is gold, land, and cows, and grains, not iPhone, not car, because that is dravya, you know, that gets destroyed fast. This dhan doesn't get destroyed. So then he said, they give dhan to the girl, not to the father of the girl, not to the girl's family. If the father takes the money, then he gets the sin of selling his daughter. And if the man, the boy's father is giving money, then he gets the sin of buying the daughter. He cannot do that. Therefore, whatever the wealth comes, it goes to the future wife of this person's son. And when the daughter gets married, that time the father, the concept of stridhan is there. But dowry is not there. Dowry is man-made. And stridhan is God-made. So he gives the stridhan. The father and the mother gives the stridhan. And what is this stridhan? The stridhan is good amount. It is given to their daughter who is going to their husband's place with the intention of, and again, the Shastra also says, a husband cannot touch that, because if he touches, he loses his credibility of a manliness. वो स्त्री धन है, उसको स्पर्श नहीं कर सकता, ही कैनॉट टच इट. सो वेन शी हैज द धन गिवन बाय हर फादर एंड मदर एंड धन गिवन बाय हर फादर इन लॉ, दैट बिकम्स हर वेल्थ. एंड इन द एमरजेंसी, इफ देर इज एनी एमरजेंसी, शी कैन टेल हर हस्बैंड, डोंट वरी, आई एम देयर फॉर यू. देर इज अ कंप्लीट फियरलेसनेस ऑफ प्रोटेक्शन बिकॉज द वेल्थ इज देयर. द लॉयल्टी इज मेंटेन्ड बिकॉज द वेल्थ इज ऑल्सो देयर. सो देन इवेंचुअली अनफॉर्चुनेटली स्त्री धन वॉज गॉन एंड द फादर वुड नॉट गिव मनी, रैदर दे वुड गेट मनी फ्रॉम द डॉटर, दैट इज ऑफ द डाउरी सिस्टम बिगेन. हाँ, द शास्त्रस डू स्पीक द गर्ल्स फादर आउट ऑफ great appreciation on his own as a voluntary basis would honor, give something to, you know, his son-in-law also, but it was never compulsory. But just see where from shastra, from where it has gone to which place. Now because we did not follow the scriptural rule properly, now the government has to make it the legal system. Whenever something is made a legal system, that shows that we have come down from reality. If it is based on shastra, then it is inspiration. But if it is based on legal, then it is forced. You are always content. So here, therefore, Arjuna, very interestingly, very beautifully, after hearing from Krishna, he said, you be good to the good people, but to bad people, you don't be good. You remain good, but use the evil. A dharma can be used, a lie can be used, but don't become a liar. Now that is the thin line, right? If you remain good, you'll be exploited. If you use good, there is a chance that you also be addicted to being bad. Dushyasana was evil. He had the habit of being evil, but Krishna used lie, but he never became a liar. So Pandavas used the lie, but they never became liar. And eventually, they ruled the country, the Bharat Varsha, for 36 good years. And the legacy continued. Parikshit Maharaj ruled for 60 years. So people don't see that. Arjuna's war, Krishna inspiring Arjuna to take his decision to empower himself to battle against Bhishma, Dronacharya and Kripacharya only caused limitless dharma so that hundreds of people could practice spirituality, Krishna consciousness. And therefore, if you study in this purport, Prabhupada talks very systematically that if systems are not proper, Kula Dharma is not functioning properly, then people can't even become devotees of Krishna. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Any? Any questions or comments? Yes.
Thank you for that discourse. Probably it was very enlightening. I do have to. I come here for the first time and listen to you. Very, very interesting discourse of yours. So you mentioned in the beginning that it's the most difficult choice is to choose between two evils. Other choices are very easy. So you spoke extensively about wrongdoings of Kauravas, Bhishma, and also you appreciated that it's good to find good things from evil persons, but we should also look for wrong things in the good people, you know, the Pandavas, to not make those mistakes. How to understand what is dharma and what is not? But and not before brothers of Pandavas. So in this complicated, I mean, I find it complicated, and I'm questioning it. I'm learning about it. So why do you say that Pandavas were on the dharma side and Kauravas were not? Given these facts.
Okay. I just wrote a book on this also. All the controversies of Mahabharata and Ramayana. You have it here. I've given it to our, it's called as real side. But the major, important principle what was there, if you read Mahabharata carefully, basically what happened, most of the time, whatever stories are circulated in the internet, people have written books. You know, like recently somebody came up after the Bahubali's success, okay? So somebody said that they want to do Mahabharata, spending 1,000 crore rupees. And what book they are choosing, the book written by one Malayali author, story from Bhima, making Bhima as a hero. But you know what they have done in that? People take some aspect of Mahabharata in isolation and present it like that. Like you talked about, Vyasadeva is so honest, he is neutral. He is related to both the parties. So Vyasadeva is the only person, when people say victors have written the history, but Mahabharata is not like that. Mahabharata talks about the weakness of the Pandavas and the evil of the Kauravas. There is a difference between Pandavas' weakness and Kauravas' evil. Kauravas were evil through and through. Destructive mentality. Now your choice between Yudhishthira and Duryodhana. Yes, Yudhishthira Maharaj made a mistake. We all agree. But then you have a choice between Yudhishthira and Duryodhana. Therefore, to look for 100% pure leader in the material world, other than God, it is not possible. You have to choose between. Yudhishthira Maharaj made that mistake. In fact, Krishna told Draupadi, anyone who was involved in this crime, I will punish them. And he punished everybody. Then the question is, why he did not punish the Pandavas? They were served because they were protected by Draupadi. Draupadi was their wife. So therefore, what was their punishment for 13 years, day in, day out? They had to see Draupadi's crying face. They went through so much of repentance. If you read the Mahabharata, very, very clearly it talks about it. And Draupadi did not just keep quiet. She remained loyal, but she always talked about this thing. She was not irritating. She was not pecking on them. She was talking philosophical concepts. So for someone like the Pandavas to hear that continuously, like the Shastras also to talk about, somebody is very good, some very good personality makes a big mistake. Even I remember one student from one engineering college, we did big mistakes. So justice saw his record. They said, entire record is so good. And whatever mistake he has made, it has not like raping somebody, murdering somebody, but it was a big mistake. So they gave him a minor punishment. He said, such a talented person, so it is a loss of the state. From that perspective, they give lesser punishment was given, but the lesser punishment was given. So to eliminate Yudhishthira Maharaj for his mistake, and again we have to study his mistake, where it happened, why did he gamble? If you only see from a mistake perspective, then you only see humanness there. The aspect of Daiva is also there. Therefore, all this entire Mahabharata had to be seen from overall perspective. Cannot pull out the stories. So I've dealt with that. And then Pandava is going to hell. Now again, that is another people who talk, Pandava went to hell, what is the point? They did not go to hell. It was a test to Yudhishthira Maharaj. What was the test? The test was, after the 36 years of ruling of the Pandavas, then they decided to quit. So as they were going to Mahaprasthan, going back to the, their ultimate destination, one by one person started dropping. First, Draupadi dropped. So Bhima asked, why was she dropping? He said, Draupadi was equally everybody's wife, but she had special affection for Arjuna. That is her humanness. And what brings death to us? Humanness brings death to us. The daivatva will not bring us death. There has to be some humanness, therefore somebody dies. Now she fell down. Pandava started walking. Now there is one lady author. Her book became very famous, called as Palace of Illusion. And it's a book full of illusion only. Why? Because she's pulling out the story which is not mentioned in the scripture. Many psychologists in India recommend that book for people to read. In the colleges also. So when I saw that book, so what she says, when Draupadi fell down and Yudhishthira Maharaj kept walking, so she construes, she says, actually Draupadi felt, what the hell these guys? I should have married Karna only. She would ever want to marry Karna in any time. He said she's a prostitute. You know, she can be made naked in public also. Anywhere. But this story is so prevalent among young people. You know, this was Draupadi saying, what the hell, I married Yudhishthir. You know, he's so hard-hearted. Let us continue. Then Nakul falls. Then Sahadeva falls. Then Arjun falls. Then Bhima falls. Yudhishthira Maharaj continues walking. There was a dog which was following Yudhishthira Maharaj. And two messengers of Dharma and Indra came. They said, come, let us go to heaven. Yudhishthira Maharaj said, yes, I am ready, but you know, this dog will follow. They said, no, come on. This is not possible. Dog will not come. He said, no, it has followed me. It has to go with me. They said, are you crazy? He said, you did not stop for your brothers and wife and you are following, you are attached to this insignificant dog. He said, no. He said, the dog has followed me, but my family members are dead. He said, I cannot stay back for the dead people. What can I do for the dead people? So Yudhishthira Maharaj had a clarity in his understanding. He was not cruel. He was not desensitized. He was not hard-hearted. They died. When you go to Himalayas, when you're walking, the whole principle of walking towards Himalayas means people do go to Himalayas with the intention of dropping their body only. Because you're done with life. People should not go to Himalayas as a tourist. When you're done with life, you have to walk. Uttar Disha means going upward, 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 so that the body drops dead. Then you move on with your life till you also drop dead. That is part of the spiritual practice. So he's following that. But to see from such a stupid perspective, maybe she has a problem with her husband. No, therefore she's putting that on Draupadi also. No, so then, that is the first thing. They said, you won the test. He said, you won the test because you are not sentimental. At the same time, you are loyal also. So then they went up. Then when Yudhishthira Maharaj saw, Duryodhana is sitting in the heavenly planets. They were shocked to see him. He said, what is this? How the hell is he here? He is responsible for all this war. Narad Muni said, keep quiet. Because he is heavenly planets, he has achieved heavenly planets by his virtue of being a fighter. So then Yudhishthira Maharaj said, where are my brothers? I want to go wherever they are. So then Yamadutta started taking them there. When they started taking them there, it was a stench. Painful place, you know, all rotten bodies. You know, it was stinking. He realized it is hell. So Yudhishthira Maharaj turned around. He said, I can't stand it. I want to go back. Then he heard the voice. He said, dear brother, I am Karna here. I am Arjun here. I am Bhima here. I am Nakul here. I am Sahadev here. So then Yudhishthira Maharaj said, what is this? How can they be here? They are virtuous people. How they are here? And Yudhishthira Maharaj said, I will stay with them. Rather than staying in the heavenly planets, I will stay here. Then Yamaraj and Indra made that hell disappear. He said, we were testing you. You passed the third test also. So it was a test. And the small point they made was, which is very interesting, that Yudhishthira Maharaj did tell that lie, small lie. So someone is performing duty for dharma, he is willing to go through that painful reaction. He doesn't question. He didn't question Krishna, what the hell, I am in the hell. Huh? He didn't question. He didn't say, no, you told me to. No, they are willing to, just like when you have to save somebody. When you jump into the fire, it doesn't matter whether you are saving someone or you accidentally fall. the fire will affect you. You can't say, hey, but I was saving somebody. When you go to the battlefield fighting, there is a greater chance that you will be wounded. But you don't say, I don't want to do it because, you know, I'll be wounded there. Because if you want to do something good, the bad will come along with that. So they pass that test. And what happened to Duryodhan? Duryodhan experienced heaven for small time. No, it was small time because he had to suffer his reactions. First he enjoyed the heaven. Then comes the hell for him, longer time. So therefore, when you read carefully the Mahabharata, what Pandavas experienced was a test for Yudhishthira Maharaj and small glimpse of hell. You know, that experience of hell, not actually hell. So unfortunately, people just pull out few verses from here and there. Oh, Pandavas also went to hell, so what is the point? No. Certainly they had weakness, but they were not wicked. Yudhishthira Maharaj never gambled in his life. But he had some inquisitiveness about gambling. So that inquisitiveness was misused by the Kauravas. How? Because when after the death of Shishupal, Yudhishthira Maharaj asked Vyasdev, he said, how is that he got killed in the battlefield? He got killed in this beautiful ceremony of Rajasuya. You know, it was glorification of Krishna, helping his father get higher destination. Then how this happened, Vyasdev? And Vyasdev said, my dear Yudhishthir, using you as an instrument, after 13 years, there will be a great catastrophe. Lokakshaya. Because the Lord had come to establish Dharma. So therefore, there will be a great catastrophe, but you will be instrument for that catastrophe. But Yudhishthira Maharaj thought, I am responsible for it. There is a difference. You being responsible and you being instrument. So he thought he is responsible. Therefore, he took a vow that whatever my superiors tell me, whatever my superiors tell me, I will follow their order so that I will not be responsible for this bloodshed. Therefore, when Dhritarashtra called him for a gambling match, he said, I am going because he is my superior. So when it all changed, after Krishna came and he said, hey, look, even if the superior tells, you respect him, but discard his instruction. If your superior tells you, it could be your parents also, beta, if you love me, he said, yes, then don't chant Hare Krishna. He said, yes, I respect you, Dad. You know, I will not discard you. I will not leave your company, but this I cannot do. Prahlad Maharaj did that. So therefore, dharma is certainly complex, but Vyasdeva makes it very clear in regards to Pandavas' weakness he talks about, but there is no evil in the Pandavas. And unfortunately, the modern authors, they try to prove, oh, Pandavas were also exactly like that only. No. They made a blunder. Like one time I was doing a program for the prisoners in Kolhapur. Big prison, you know. Kolhapur is known for a lot of Kshatriyas, fighters. So the police commissioner said, do you want to do a program for the prisoner? I said, no problem. I thought maybe a few pickpocketers will be there. It turned out to be 300 murderers. I thought, you know, there'll be a barricade between me and them. But just like I'm sitting here, like that we were sitting with 300 murderers. So now what to speak? If you make some mistake, you know, then one more addition to their number. So then when I went there, they were more normal than all of us. Because 90% of them, they did this act in accident. And the jailer told me, professional murderers never come here. Professional murderers only come here when they fear that their protectors can eliminate them. That time they come here. He said, these are all actually innocent people because of some mistake they made, that murder. The murder is done. Therefore, they are getting punished also. But when we had lecture with them, kirtan, one of the best kirtan I ever had, they were all dancing with great happiness. They said, phir se ek bar aa jao. You know, I said, I'll come for kirtan only. So like that, so to see good in bad is correct. But to see weakness in good is right. But to say that, oh no, they're also equally like, you know, like Duryodhan, that is not fair, that is not correct, that is not in the Mahabharata. No? So therefore, dharma and adharma, the dharma sankat is always there for the dharmic people. But for adharmic people, they're ruthless. There is no conflict in them. They don't have any conflict. They will use dharma, they will use adharma, and they will grow by whatever means. If it is meant killing Dhritarashtra, he would kill. It is meant killing, and that's what they learned. One of the consultant, one who came to tell the Kauravas, they said, look, for your growth, you should be able to kill your family members, your own relatives. And this is what Karna tells Krishna. When Krishna told Karna, he said, why are you working for him? He said, no, he's my friend, I will not quit him. And then what Karna says, he said, nobody can trust Duryodhan. He's evil. He's against the Brahminical culture. Can you imagine, he's telling that, but he said, but I'll still fight on behalf of Karna only, on Duryodhan only, because he's my friend. He was suicidal. That is the point. Hare Krishna. I'll stop here. Okay. Any questions? Yes.
We have our own bad things within us and we are fighting that to be good, but then there are really gross elements of evil and you know we are trying to turn that into good. Like sometimes you know you go and try like going to a prison and if that was a genuine murderer and trying to teach him.
So therefore the world is world of duality, dvandva. That is first principle of this material world, dvandva. Forget people, even good qualities, determination. Determination independently, you cannot say it is good or bad. Only when it is applied, determination can turn into stubbornness also. Same determination, when it is applied in a wrong place, at the wrong people, with the wrong intention, you are determined, but it can turn into a stubbornness also. Honesty, for example. Honesty, what is honesty? Honesty is an emotion. Because if there is right kind of, like you may say, okay, this is what happened. But the tone in which you say, that honesty could be called as shamelessness. We have a lot of politicians. They say, oh no, this is what I did. What can you do? They already told now the truth. You know, you can't hang them also because they're shameless. Sometimes they may be honest. There is an element of arrogance. You know, I have done it. Who cares? Right. And somebody may be honest by saying, you know, what can I do? I'm saying. So they don't want to empower themselves. They want to stay there only. They're saying that we're weak rather than saying they're honest. So honesty, what does it do? It empowers you to deal with your limitations and focus on your potential. So everybody, the beauty of our scriptures is when Hanumanji came to Lanka, what do you think he saw first? When he saw Ravan first, what was his response? When Ram saw Ravan, what was his response? Ram said, wow, what a power. What prabhav. What a power, what a control he has. If he was dharmic, then he could have ruled the entire world. So Lord Ram saw potential in Ravan also. Same thing Hanumanji also did. Therefore, similarly, when Jai Vijay, when they came down as Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyaksha, the Vaikuntha Dutas, they told Lord Narasimha, my dear Lord, he is ultimately your servant only. It is your pastime that they are acting as demonic forces. Other devatas, according to their needs, their concern, they had different kind of perception about Jai Vijay. But Vaikuntha Vasis saw their potential. Therefore, when we understand, nobody in this world, Prabhupada talks about this. He said, demons are very few. But unfortunately, they control the world. Most people are innocently sinful. Nobody can be, can anybody say, and I'm as demonic as Hiranyakashipu? Forget Hiranyakashipu. You know, one of the mafias also, you cannot be like that. To become, why these mafias are very famous? Because they're actually, you know, they have a lot of courage. In Mumbai, you know, where I stay, people talk about the mafias as much as they talk about the heroes also. Because somewhere there is that attraction, because these guys are really adventurous. So what Shastra says, you are not like Prahlad and neither you are like Hiranyakashipu. So your weaknesses are there, your potential also there. So by practicing spiritual sadhana, you can minimize your weakness, maximize your potential. That is what the bhakti is. Therefore Krishna said, Tasma Sarveshu Kaleshu Ma Manusmara Yudhach. If you are struggling on your own to perfect your life, not possible. If you are hoping that everything Krishna will do, that is also not possible. You offer your efforts with love and devotion, then the grace of God comes. That is the beauty of the journey. The journey is that if everything is completely bad, there is no question of journey only. If everything is so good, then you are complacent. The struggle is not there. So therefore, this good and bad. Therefore, in Kali Yuga especially, as Prabhupada explains, the demons are sitting inside only. So depending upon what do you water, what are you watering? If you are watering the wrong plant, the Manyumaya Dhruma, Duryodhan tree, then that will flourish. If you are planting the Yudhishthira tree, that will flourish. Therefore, that challenge is with us only. And that's the beauty of journey. It's an adventurous journey. It is not difficult. It is not confusing. It's a beautiful, adventurous journey. Everybody experienced. Prahlad Maharaj, he was a great devotee, but his grandson, Bali Maharaj, had to go through his journey. He could have been like Hiranyakashipu as his example. He could have had Prahlad as his example. Till then, he had chosen Hiranyakashipu as his example. And he wanted to be the king of the entire three planetary system. But with Prahlad's presence, with Lord Vamandev's special grace, he said, Krishna, take everything from me. So that step, that process is, therefore satsang is there, therefore the scriptures are there, therefore the sadhana is there, so that we minimize our demonic qualities and maximize our divine qualities. Hare Krishna. Yeah. One simple principle that if you actually see that in any war, any when dharma has to be established, you don't get people who are useless. You have to take the most dedicated people. Only those who are extremely dedicated, willing to lay down their life. That is how the entire itihas shows that only. So Mahabharata and Ramayana are the original itihas. They're telling us what actually takes you to establish dharma. Why people go to watch Bahubali movie? Because nobody has to do anything. The whole principle of life, what has happened, why we celebrate synthetic heroes like the sports people and the Bollywood people? Because we don't have to take any responsibility. Bahubali will do everything. When Krishna came to this world, when devatas approached the Lord, you read that part. When devatas approached Lord Ram, he said, all of you come down and invest your responsibility also. And the greater ability you have, greater character you have, greater responsibility will be given to you. That is the role of life. In temple, in company, in government, if you are a good servant, the minister will call you because he wants to be successful, no? Like I was talking to this very famous police officer of Maharashtra, Arvind Inamdar. Very famous. In his entire career of 35 years, 29 times he was transferred. 29 times he was transferred. As the boss of the entire, he had 200,000 police under him, 20,000 police officer under him, 200 IPS under him. He could have made traffic police make so much of money. He could have made so much of money. Never took one penny. He said, all credit goes to my wife because she never demanded more than what I could give her. He was telling me. He's a very nice person, very nice person, dedicated his entire life doing the teachings of Karma Yoga, Bhagavad Gita. And he would say, the Maharashtrian, he would say, I don't work for this all Chaprasi ministry. He said, I'm working for Shivaji Maharaj. No? Like that his spirit was. So when he was last year, he was on the top position. There was a minister who was like so corrupt. He couldn't imagine only. He was shocked. He said, look, sir, he said, responsibility lies with me. But you are doing everything on your own. Either you take the responsibility also and give me the decision-making power also. This is not going to happen like this. He was very blunt, this officer. So he realized that this guy is not going to listen. So he resigned 1 year early. So resigning 1 year early means what? He was telling. Very interesting. He said, for me, resigning 1 year early means losing all my salary for 1 year. That was about 200,000 rupees. It's a big money because they had not taken any bribe. And plus, every month his pension was reduced for 3,000 rupees. That was 36,000 rupees less every year. So he said, to be virtuous, you have to pay a price. Virtue also doesn't come without price. But then that decision you have to make. And then he said, that same minister now sitting in jail. The virtue has a price to pay and the evil has interest to give. So therefore, in Sita, you take Rama and Abhimanyu, the most dear to Krishna. What Krishna did not receive from Kamsa, Krishna did for Abhimanyu. He said, I did not get that affection from my mama, uncle. But I want to give everything to Abhimanyu because Abhimanyu was fathered by Krishna only because the Pandavas were in the forest. He did everything for Abhimanyu. But could Krishna save him? He can save, but he's telling us the realities of life. Don't go to the Lord asking that, protect my material body also. Pandavas lost all their 5 sons. Draupadi, for example, she lost her sons. She lost Abhimanyu, lost her father, lost her 3 brothers. And then what? That her grandsons did not become king. Subhadra's grandson became the king. She could have said, Krishna, all sacrifice mine and you are making king from your family only. You know, so you see, therefore the whole principle of why people don't want to be teacher nowadays, they want good teachers to teach their children, but said, I don't want to be teacher. Where will they come from? Because teacher's life is a life of sacrifice. You know, there was a concept in India which is called as inspired poverty. If there is no inspired poverty, there is imposed poverty will come. Now some number of people have to live a life of inspired poverty. If that is not there, then there will be problem will come. So therefore when society, the world is designed such a way that the good people have to make a greater sacrifice. And who can do greater sacrifice other than Lord Ram's own consort Sita? Only she can handle. Only Radharani can handle. Only people like Prabhupada can handle. And if they do that, then most of the people can live a very, very stable life. Not everybody has to go through that, but their sacrifice is much greater. So at least we can sacrifice for our family, our society, our Krishna consciousness practices. So if it is not for Sita, Lakshman, see Lakshman's life, see Urmila's life. Sometimes people sacrifice so greatly, but they are not even recognized only. Some heroes are recognized, some heroes are not recognized. But they are the one who build that brick by brick, brick by brick, brick by brick. But they are not seen. But that is the beauty of the scriptures. Hare Krishna.
Yes.
Are there to play a part, and apparently even there are some devotees who have come down, like Jai Vijay and all of them. So is it the same thing for Ravan and Kans? And if it is, then these devotees, I mean, normally when we're not devotees, we like, oh, I hate Ravan and I hate this and I like this and I like that. But should we be going above that sort of a emotion and just focus on chanting and that's it, not worry about all this analysis?
Because the life is, why did then they perform this pastime? Pastime is meant to teach. Why does the Lord appear in a human form? One is Leela and second is lesson. Leela without lesson, then we can do anything and everything and say, oh, this is all Krishna's will only. Like somebody put that salt in Charanamrit, and when Prabhupada tested, and he said, what is this? He said, Prabhupada, Krishna's will. I said, no, your head. No? So then we will say everything as Leela, as Krishna's will. Then we will not take the responsibility. If you read the Bhagavatam 4th canto, the fall of Jai Vijay was predicted by the Lord. Because they offended the four Kumaras. They offended Lakshmi also. And not all the demons. Now, Duryodhana is not a devotee. Duryodhana is a Kali personified. You know, he is actually a demon. So therefore, there are many people who are demonic, and there are some people who come as devotees, who play that Jai Vijay, Hiranyakashipu, Hiranyaksha, and then Shishupal and Dantavakra, Ravan and Kumbhakarna. Not every demon is sent by Krishna to perform the pastime. Some demons are actual demons only. So they need to be eliminated. So therefore, in chanting Hare Krishna, if you don't have a job, if you don't have anything to eat, how many people are able to chant Hare Krishna? How many can be Kunti, Krishna, keep giving me suffering? No, unless there is a stability of life, most people cannot handle. Therefore, Dharma, Krishna comes to establish Dharma so that others can have a stable life, not complacent life. If your temple, you say, hey, after all, we have to come and chant Hare Krishna. The electricity is not working. In the winter, you know, the heater is not working. When you come for the program, the president says, hey, you came now, you chant Hare Krishna only, because ultimately cooking has to happen, buying has to happen, bargaining has to happen, the pot has to be there. You know, so much of war, so much of systems are involved. All these systems involved means governance has to be there. To have a good governance, efficiency has to come. For being efficient, honesty has to be there. All these qualities, so you are creating Mahabharata. We cannot avoid Mahabharata and Ramayana. That is not possible only. Because governance has to be there. Therefore, all these analyses are made by our acharyas only. No, they only made this analysis. Why would Krishna? Krishna said, very good Arjun, let us go back to Vrindavan. You know, I play flute, you dance. You know, forget all this war. And Duryodhana was very happy. Wow, he said, Krishna played more flute. You know, that is good for me. Why would Krishna leave Vrindavan? What is the purpose of leaving Vrindavan? In fact, he stayed only 10 years in Vrindavan. And 115 years he was moving around everywhere, establishing Dharma. And Krishna is the most, you know, nishkam karma yogi. Because every time he comes, he gets greatest number of criticism. Ram and Krishna are criticized the most. Lord Narayan is never criticized. You don't see Lord Narayan is criticized. You don't see Lord Narsingdev is criticized so much. But when Krishna and Ram, they come to this world, every time they come, forget this one, very interesting, when Yudhishthira Maharaj told a lie. Now this is in the Mahabharata. So then Bhim was telling, kill him fast, tell the lie and finish him off. And Arjuna was not. Arjuna's affection for Dronacharya. So Yudhishthira Maharaj eventually told the lie and Dronacharya was killed by Drishtadyumna. Arjuna became very emotional. And he said, Yudhishthira, what is this? For the small piece of kingdom, you have done such a great crime that you have killed by lying. He said, you have done such a dharma. You have done same thing like what Lord Ram did against Vali, killed him from behind. And who is there standing only? There Ram is standing. Why? Krishna did not take it seriously. Why he did not take seriously? Because Arjuna is emotional. And another principle is that even person like Arjuna can question Ram's behavior. So Ram cannot say, I did everything for the society and they are condemning me, so I'll never come back again to this material world. No, he said, I will keep my doing duty. I will come. I will protect. Forget Sita in the Ramayana, you read. Can you imagine Lakshman did everything for her and when they heard the voice, perceptions, you know, perceptions are very interesting. Both heard. Marij saying, hey Sita, hey Lakshman, hey Sita, hey Lakshman. But both had a different response only. Lakshman said, no force in the world, all the demons, all the kinnaras, all the rakshas, all the daivatas, everyone put together, they cannot touch Lord Ramachandra. He had confidence. And Sita on the other hand, she had concern. Both heard the same sound. One out of affection, she is concerned. And other brother, na, are usko kuch nahi hoga, nothing will happen to you. So there was a conflict between concern and confidence. And the concern became very aggressive. Sita, she said, you are here waiting Ram to be killed so that you can enjoy me. Can you imagine? Lakshman closed his eyes and said, my God, you know. He didn't say, I served you so many years and you're saying all these things. He ran there. He said, he realized, you know, I can't stay here now because she is going to create trouble. While going, Lakshman also said, all women are less intelligent only. Now you can't quote that as Odeko. You know, he is saying. He is also an outburst. She is also an outburst. Then when Lakshman went there, Ram said, what are you doing here? I told you to be there. So Lakshman was questioned by Ram for his competency. And Sita questioned his integrity. When your competency and integrity question, then you should commit suicide. But he continued to serve. Same thing with Yudhishthira Maharaj. Yudhishthira Maharaj, can you imagine ever speaking any harsh word to anybody? His expectations were not fulfilled when Arjuna came in the middle of the battle. Because Arjuna saw that Yudhishthira Maharaj's flag is not to be seen. So he told Krishna, Krishna, I think something has happened wrong to Yudhishthira. Please take me to his camp. Now Arjuna is not the one who leaves the battle in the middle and comes and... So he came with the intention of his brother's welfare. When Yudhishthira saw Arjuna, he had expectation that he has come giving the message of the death of Karna. He said, have you killed Karna? He said, no, I came looking for you. He said, hell with you. He said, I don't know why I trusted you. I should have trusted Nakul. I should have used him to kill Karna. You're a useless guy. That was okay. And then he said, now you can imagine Yudhishthira Maharaj saying that. He said, my mother should have aborted you in the 5th month only. And then he said, hell with your Gandibo. Throw that Gandibo in a garbage can. Then Arjuna came to kill his brother. He didn't mind him saying that my mother should have aborted you. He didn't mind. He said, throw the Gandiva bow. Because he had taken a vow that anybody says anything against my Gandiva bow, I'll kill them. Krishna said, whom are you killing? I don't see any enemies here. Everybody is well-wisher. He said, no, this person, my brother, he has said like that. Then Krishna said, my dear Arjun, did you hear him? Or did you feel him? So Krishna said, don't give importance to the words. Feel him. Why does he say like that? Are they not good lessons in life? So many times we hear rather than we feel people. When Draupadi questioned Krishna. Krishna gave her sari. Limitless sari he gave. And what does Draupadi tell Krishna when she meets? Very beautiful pastime in the Mahabharata. So she is crying, weeping. She chastised Arjuna, hell with Gandiva. That time Arjuna did not kill her. You know, his vow didn't work there. Because he knows she should kill me rather than I should kill her. Then she said, you know, useless people. They all shut down their mouth. And she told Krishna, at least you should have protected me for four reasons. I'm your devotee. I'm your friend. I'm a woman. I'm a queen. For this four reasons, you should have protected me. Even you did not come to protect me. What should Krishna say? Hey, you know, he could speak her philosophy and curse her. You know, you are such an ungrateful woman that I gave. Tere baap ne diya kya saadi? He could have said like that. But he didn't say all that. He said, I am sorry, I was fighting the war elsewhere. If I was there, I would have never allowed to happen. So it is not the event which is important. What will make Draupadi feel to overcome that trauma? So these are the sensitive things which Krishna is teaching. Usually when there is a fight between two people, especially husband and wife, either party is looking for affection, attention, but we remind them what we have done to them. I did so much for you. Are that I know. No? The child also same thing. The parents are reminding what all the lists they bring. I did so much. But they are not looking for that. They know. They are looking for that affection. So Krishna so beautifully told Arjun. He said, did you see why is he saying like that? Don't hear his words. Understand the background behind it. Therefore, Lakshman understood. Therefore, he never quit the service of Sita. Lakshman understood Ram. You know, therefore he never quit his service. He didn't bring back Ram. Remember in the forest what you told me? I'll never forget that. People, that's what we do now. We'll never forget. Therefore, Gita teaches us, do not suffer more than the suffering deserves. And do not enjoy your success more than your success deserves. Because you have a next match to play. You know, next ball to throw. Because if you celebrate your success, oh, I took the wicket of Sachin Tendulkar. Or the next batsman will come and hit you six. Don't celebrate success more than it deserves. Because life is continuous battle. Keep fighting and enjoy the fight rather than the success or failure. And that's what Prabhupada taught. He said, if I fail, let me fail in America rather than failing in United Kingdom. Hare Krishna. Jai Srila Prabhupada ki.
So those who